Good morning, Mrs Hinch.
Had a letter from Etty this morning. My sister, Etty General. She quite agrees.
Agrees?
What I said. It's getting too much for me, the walk up from Strand Street three times a week. Carrying Hobson in his cage. Doing the shopping on the way. Dark in winter time, General, the time I start home again. Hobson's no protection, you know.
You know, I cannot understand why you bring a parrot to my house in the first place, Mrs. Hinch.
General, dear, you are funny.
Am I?
Etty says it's ridiculous. Trailing all the way up from Strand Street three times a week when there's a perfectly good spare room in Ivy Cottage.
Look, there is no question of your living in, Mrs. Hinch. We've been through all that, but haven't I explained to you?
My dear, what you need is a woman about the place. You need someone here at nights. Bit of company. Me and Hobson.
No, Mrs. Hinch. No!
Cantankerous, cantankerous!
I shall be out today, Mrs. Hinch. I have a busy day ahead of me.
Busy, my dear?
Tell me, why shouldn't I have a busy day?
Meeting Miss Lorimer from that school, eh?
Miss Lorimer? Yes, I might see Miss Lorimer, yes. Why shouldn't I?
Saucy little thing she is. No kind of a companion for you, really. Pity the poor old Colonel went over the rainbow, eh?
Mrs. Hinch, I must request you not to speak of my friends in that familiar manner. Good heavens, you are employed here as my charwoman. Well, I dislike having to remind you of that.
Sure, General, sure. I was only remarking. Yeah, tell you what, though. It's a good day for you and a dodgy one for me. I read it in Lord Luck. I mustn't make decisions. My judgment is not at its best today.
Is it not? In that case, don't forget the stairs, Mrs. Hinch. You forgot them on Tuesday.
For you, it's all romance, a time for fresh associations. Here's a day for the General, I remarked to Hobson. A new regime is on the way.
Oh, and what did Hobson reply?
General Hobson's my little bird.
Yes, I am aware of that, Mrs. Hinch. I only wondered, since the animal is a parrot, why the powers of speech should be beyond it. It's not so with other parrots.
Hobson's silent, General. You know Hobson's silent.
Due to your lethargy, Well, no bird of his nature need be silent, Mrs. Hinch. God does not intend it. God has taken great pains to equip the parrot with the instruments of speech. It is therefore up to you to train the animal to pursue the matter in a practical way. The mother teaches, Mrs. Hinch. It's just part of nature.
I've brought up 7 children, 4 boys and 3 girls, more than you, General.
Oh, I've known my share of women, Mrs. Hinch, despite my bachelor state.
General, of course you have.
Yes, I fought a duel once over a woman.
Yes, General, you told me.
Yes, on the shores of the Nile on a sultry Tuesday morning. It seems like yesterday. Well, be careful of the handles of those cups, Mrs. Hinch, when you come to wash them.
Flimsy, General. Declare to God I should be glad to see the last of them.
Yes, but not I, Mrs. Hinch. I like those cups. Tea tastes better out of fine china, so I'd take it kindly if you just washed and dried them with greater care.
Hoity!
Mrs. Hinch! Mrs. Hinch. I have decided that the time has come when you and I must part company.
What do you mean, General?
I mean, I cannot have you addressing me in the way you do, or talking about my friends in that familiar manner, or continuing to bring a parrot into my house.
Hobson must have me by him, you know that.
I do not know that, Mrs. Hinch. So, at the end of the week, I'll pay you for next week and the week after, and I'd be very grateful if you did not come on Tuesday. You understand, Mrs. Hinch? Mrs. Hinch, I'm speaking to you!
Pretty, aren't they?
No. Mrs Hinch, you are not moving into this house. So take these things away. Take them right away and all the other things.
What other things, Jeff?
Do you think I'm unaware that you've been filling my spare room with your hideous knick-knacks? I tell you, I do not require a living in servant, Mrs Hinch. In fact, I do not require your services at all. As from today...
Calm now, my dear. Sit yourself down. It's not the thing at all at your age, rampaging on like this. I'm sorry if I was familiar, sir, and for presuming in the matter of the spare room. I simply thought that it would be more convenient all round.
Please take your money, Mrs. Hinch. Please take it.
I only thought, and Etty agreed, that you at your age, something might happen. You'll find it hard to get another lady to do for you, sir.
Very well, then. I'll just have to do for myself, won't I?
We understand each other, sir. Let the world go by now, my dear.
Let the world go by. I have never let the world go by, Mrs. Hinch, and I don't intend doing so now.
Here. Take your silly money.
Look, Mrs. Hinch. Mrs. Hinch, I'm asking you to go. I'm asking you to go, Mrs. Hinch. And I mean it. I do mean it. You cow! Oh, you awful old cow! No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
That sale of work today, don't forget, in aid of the old folks. You could take your little Miss Lorimer. Don't forget this. You know she likes to look at your photographs.
Your album again.
Well, of course. It has a certain period interest, you know, but nothing more.
No.
Well, I'm a period piece myself, my dear.
Of course you're not.
I'm not complaining. I've had a good life. I just find it funny being old, that's all. Just occasionally.
General? Good morning,
Muriel. Good morning.
Yep.
Well, it's to be a good day for me today, Muriel, according to Mrs. Hinch and the stars. Yep. I don't exactly feel it, I must say.
Oh, but you're looking marvellous, General.
Oh, thank you.
You're very good for your age, you know. Isn't that true, Miss Lorimer? Isn't he great for his years? I mean, a man of the age that rode a horse to war. Was it the charge of the Light Brigade you was informing me about the other day, General? Terrible carnage, Miss Lorimer, terrible. But didn't he come up smiling? Old soldiers never die. Ever heard that one, General?
It sounds familiar. Well, now, how is everything at St Monica's, eh? How is the breathtaking Miss Heaslip?
General Suffolk,
I'm sorry. Look, there's a sale of work over at the church this afternoon. I thought that we might walk over there after lunch, perhaps.
I have something to tell you.
Yeah? Muriel, dear, what's on?
Oxtail, General. Beef or curry, sprouts and carrots, creamed and tapioca.
A bottle of Nuit Saint-Georges or to effectively disguise all that.
Miss Heaslip says it's disloyal to see you, disloyal to her and to St. Monica's. When I first met you, I didn't realize...
Your Miss Heaslip is a thin bitch.
She's my headmistress, General. I just can't go against her wishes.
But why not? Why not? The woman doesn't make sense.
I didn't know. I didn't realize. You didn't tell me. You once gave the senior girls tennis lessons.
Nor did I tell you that after I left the regiment, I was the secretary of a golf club for a while. That didn't last long either. I just couldn't stand those awful men with zips.
Oh, goodness sake, what have men with zips got to do with it?
Well, briefly, they had to do with me. After a lifetime of something else, well, I didn't want to go to seed immediately. I was invited to give tennis lessons at your St. Monica's because I had once been something of an expert at the game. In fact, we did not escape the beady eye of the breathtaking Miss Heaslip.
Miss Heaslip said...
Yes, we'll get the old boy cheap, is what the Heaslip said. Pensioners are 10 a penny.
I'm not talking about any of that.
Oh, yes, the elderly General Suffolk, she cooed to the parents, spry as a rabbit. You know, he held the F. Wilding to 5 sets in 1912.
Miss Heaslip didn't say that at all.
No? Well, perhaps she said that I cuddled the senior girls while pretending to teach them the serve. Is that what she said? I wish I had cuddled them. It just happens not to be true.
I've enjoyed our chats ever since that first day. You don't know what it's meant, having someone to talk to and to listen to with pleasure.
Oh, look. Emily Dottington. She said I'd lead her a dance, so she took up with a most frightful fool instead. Oh, yes, some real trouble upstairs, by all accounts. Also, he had some difficulty with the waterworks, I believe. The fellow just couldn't stand still. Where are you going?
I've told you, General, and I'm very sorry.
Oh, but Miss Lorimer... Miss Lorimer, I invited you to lunch.
Yes, I know.
Look, this is your day off. The Heaslip has no right to interfere with the spare time of her employees. But wait a minute. Just stay and sit down for a minute. Will you look over there or something? After I left St. Monica's, those senior girls came up to see me one day. And behind the prim countenance of the breathtaking Miss Heaslip, there was a mind, they said, like a sewerage system. Those girls gave me tobacco and cigarettes to reassure me, and a cake that they'd made, and also some packets of vegetable seeds, for some reason. Oh, Miss Lorimer, I had hoped that you would help me find another charwoman.
Have you sacked Mrs. Hinch?
No, I'm fighting the last battle of my life with Mrs. Hinch.
There are other chars about, I'm sure there are.
Yes, but you come and housekeep for me, Miss Lorimer. Come to Ivy Cottage. Look, we're well met, you know. We get on well enough, and we share a taste or two, and, you cook, I dare say. and the housework is light.
Please, don't start that again. You know, it's quite impossible.
I wouldn't lay a finger on you, Miss...
Please, General.
Well, that school's a frightful place, and here am I being driven mad by this woman. So why shouldn't we? Now, why shouldn't we just solve our two problems with one fell swoop? Well, you're Well, you're a lonely heart, Miss Lorimer. And I'm, well, I'm old. So come and housekeep for me, Miss Lorimer. Come to
no,
Ivy
Cottage. No, no, no. I've told you repeatedly.
Look, come to Ivy Cottage, Miss Lorimer. And when I cease to be old, Ivy Cottage shall be yours.
I've told you I'm perfectly happy at St. Monica's.
That's not true.
It is, it is.
But nobody could be happy at St. Monica's. Oh, Lord, those two grey knitted creatures whispering in the common room, Miss Fellon and Miss Fear. You've never known a man. And then Mademoiselle dreaming of her dentist in Toulouse, and Miss Morse the music, and Miss Tick the trigonometry, or whatever they're called. And, oh, and those under matrons stiff with starch. And Sister, oh, Sister with her change of life. And you, Miss Lorimer.
I enjoy my work.
Bloody nonsense. Look, I'll pay you well. More than Heaslip does, and with more time off. And they could all visit you if you really felt a need. You know, Miss Morse and Miss Tick and Miss Fellon and Miss Fear. And sister, if you insisted. Yes, I'd have no objection to hearing once again about sister's change of life.
But the whole idea is quite preposterous. I've no desire to be anyone's housekeeper. I am a teacher, General Suffolk. I have a vocation.
You know, sometimes I think I feel frightened. It's a silly feeling, but I just can't help it all the same. I look at her and think, she frightens me. Of course, I suppose it's my own fault. I dare say. But I've sacked her twice before. But she always comes back.
Assuming that you're all suitably poised at home, are you poised next door, gentlemen, I say? They raise thumbs and pens and things and say, yes. So, oft to coin an immortal phrase, we'll jolly well go. What a tone on that dinger. Oh, not half. Right, then, line one. One lean breast of lamb, boned and diced. There you go. All on one line. And even if it goes on two lines, it counts as one line when we audit the books. One lean breast of lamb, boned and diced.
Ah, you're looking peaky, General.
Good morning, Mrs. Considine.
Everyone in this whole town calls me Jumbo, except the General. And how's youth and vigour at St. Monica's,
Oh, all right. Everything is all right.
Good, good. You're coming to the sale, aren't you, General? Percy and I are doing the teas again. Splendid value, 15p.
Yes, well, I was trying to persuade Miss Lorimer here to...
I've bought you a new toothbrush, old chap.
What?
Would you excuse me, please, Ham? I ought to say that.
Beg your
pardon.
That jolly Mrs. Hinch said you needed a new one. I bet her buying vegetables. Honestly, the beetroot these days, 3 new pea, no bigger than a marble. She wasn't going anywhere near a chemist's. Well, naturally, I said I'd get one.
Mrs. Considine, are you telling me, or trying to tell me, that Mrs. Hinch told you that I needed a toothbrush?
You chaps never notice. No trouble at all, old fellow.
Well, I do not require a new toothbrush, Mrs. Considine. And I would point out that if I ever do require one, I still have the energy and the faculties left to, well, to enter a chemist's shop and purchase the article for myself.
I call that downright ungrateful.
Never been the same since the old colonel popped it.
No need to be rude just because your friend dies. Ridiculous going round with that schoolmarm.
Well, nobody hoping for a bit of hanky-panky with Elsie Lorimer, if that's what he's after.
Thank you, Percy. Odd as two left feet, some of these old fogies. Oh, you're going, Mrs. Adams, Miss Appleby. Bye-bye, keeping well, are you? Look after this for me, Percy. Maybe the old boy will be in a more agreeable frame of mind later on.
He usually is on his day out, tight as a tick by 7:30.
Oh, Gladys Hinch is all I can say.
Foul Fowler, the fellow's name was. He lived for 3 years in a wardrobe.
Eh?
Yes, you can see it to this day, actually, in the Imperial War Museum.
What, General?
The wardrobe.
Oh, I see, sir. Aye.
Yes, the woman who hid him got the OBE afterwards. Were a French woman by the name of Belmont Gobert.
OBE?
That's right, for hiding him in her wardrobe, John.
Why? Do you ever see The Guns of Navarone, sir?
Hmm?
The Guns of Navarone.
Guns of...
A film. It would interest you, sir.
Ooh, a film about guns, eh?
No, it's a war story, General. The Guns of Navarone's only the title.
I see. Well, yes, yes, I'll certainly be glad to come with you, Jock. I was going over to the church sailor work this afternoon, I was thinking of it, but we could drop into the Tivoli instead. Of course, I'll be only too glad to accompany my boy.
Oh, no, no, it was on at the Tivoli about 3 years ago.
Eh?
They have a thing called sexual friendship showing there at the moment.
Ah.
Is that in France, sir?
Belgium, actually. You know, talking about guns, Jock, do you realise that we entered that war with only two machine guns?
The British Army, sir?
No. I'm talking about the regiment,
Jock. Oh, I see. Yeah,
two machine guns, 24 officers, 516 NCOs and men, and 600 horses.
Oh, aye, Muriel was on about the horses. She's fascinated that you rode to war on a horse, sir.
Oh, yes, Jock, we rode to war on horses, and we fought with swords in our hands. And we fought from the trenches. In fact, Jock, we fought in almost every way you can think of.
What I meant about the Guns of Navarone, sir, was, you know, if you ever saw it on anywhere, you could bring Miss Lorimer to it.
What's that?
Isn't she having a day off today, sir?
No.
Isn't Miss Lorimer taking lunch today, sir?
Miss Lorimer? Oh, Miss Lorimer. No, Jock. No, Miss Lorimer has given me the bird.
I'm
to you, Miss Lorimer.
Nice to find a new face.
I have a photograph album that might interest you. Emily Dottington. She said I'd lead her to dance, so she took after the most frightful fool.
I fought a duel once over a woman.
That's Jenny Ormsby.
No, the one in the right.
Mrs. Gregory. I rather think I loved Mary Ann. Elsie Lorimer.
Come to Ivy Cottage.
Nice to find a new face. That's Elsie Lorimer.
Elsie Lorimer. Lorimer.
Stall in there. I should get over there. Excuse me. Yes, there's something there that I really want over there.
Isn't that nice?
Awfully good, Lorimer.
My name is General Suffolk.
That's awfully nice, I think.
Yes, it is indeed. You have quite a crowd here today, haven't you? I don't think I've seen you around here before. Tell me, are you a newcomer?
How about that? The, 5p.
No, I think not.
You're not a dealer.
General Suffolk. I hate it at St. Monica's.
Show me why, please. Tell me, yes, where can we have some tea?
Oh, tea, yes. Over there, dear.
Thank you.
It's everything you said. sinister with her endless change of life, and Mamsel dreaming of a dentist in Toulouse, and the under matrons and the grey knitting and the girls. I'm so sorry.
Thank you so much.
Well, I suddenly realised this afternoon I'm tired of pretty girls.
Mrs. Constantine, two teas, perhaps. A table over there.
Yes.
I sat for ages just staring at the sea. And then I walked and walked, just thinking what it would be like.
Like?
To be your housekeeper.
My goodness. Wait, Mrs. Lorimer, do you mean you have decided?
I will be your housekeeper.
You will.
Mrs. Lorimer, you do realize I'm a tetchy old man.
You've shown me respect. You've held doors open for me and stood as I approached as if I were a film star. Without my saying anything, you understand about St. Monica's.
Well, of course, of course.
There's no of course about it. Those girls, they look at me and think, she's unattractive. Tom Jones, they say. Isn't he fantastic? Where's Mildura, I ask. They sigh. Not knowing, not caring. And nor do I care. God knows, why should I care where Mildura is?
I know, actually I can help you there. Mildura, it's in Australia, actually. It's a town in Australia.
She's 41, they think. She's missed out. I see it in her eyes. I can hear it in their voices. Oh, Lord, they pray, let us not end up like poor Miss Lorimer, asking where a town is in some hot classroom.
In a moment, General.
Divinity and basket work, yes. Geography and rhythmics, Sunday walks, Scotch eggs for tea, Miss Heaslip in that Holy Communion frame of mind. Oh, God, those Sundays.
It should never have anything to do with that. Mrs. Mallows. Chap died last year.
I hoped you'd speak to me. That day we met on the promenade, I knew you'd understand. Something told me.
Well, I always speak to strange women, actually. I mean, if they are, well, you know. Now then, what about some tea? Hmm?
Long before you spoke to me, I used to wonder who you were.
Did you?
And then one day, in a tobacconist's, I asked, who is that dignified man?
Did you?
I'm so sorry.
No, of course not.
I've read about you.
Oh?
I've read the history of your regiment.
Really?
And your entry in Who's Who.
Have you indeed, have you?
You've done a lot.
Yes, I suppose I have. But all I want to do now, Miss Lorimer, is to get rid of the bloody Mrs. Hinch. You see, Miss Lorimer, I have to present her with a fait accompli. I have to be able to say to her, Mrs. Hinch, I have employed a housekeeper, a younger woman, far more able to do the work. And so, Mrs. Hinch, thank you for everything you've done. Now, I'd be very glad if you would go and not return.
Oh, she will. Of course she shall.
She shall, won't she? Yes, of course she will. She will. I can't help remember. I had trouble once before, terrible trouble, oh, back in the spring of 1927, I think it was, as a little thing, a girl, you know, that I no doubt foolishly, had become, well, rather fond of. Daisy Ashley, have you heard of her? I know, because she did the most marvellous imitations of stage door Johnnies. Wonderful. Musical stuff, of course, but she was brilliant. Oh, really brilliant. Mm. She wasn't at all like Mrs. Hinch.
Known a lot of women, General. In
yes.
Your album, there are.
Yes, yes, I have been fond of women. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And yet, you never married.
No. I suppose I wasn't the sort to marry. No, I suppose I was the sort that liked to have his cake and eat it. And yet, you know, it hasn't always been easy. Oh, do you know? In fact, I sometimes think that the most difficult thing in the whole world is saying goodbye to a woman that you love.
Yes, yes, I'm sure it is.
Oh, I'm going to die, I remember saying to myself, in some Middle Eastern place, as a train bumped me away from a girl who most people would think was no better than a whore. And yet there I sat, watching that dry white landscape and swearing that I would never love again. You know, I think they go together, love and war. No, no, not just because nothing's fair in either. No, no, it's the brief meetings, the snatched moments, the chill of linoleum on the feet in some tatty hotel. Oh, and the face. Oh, the face on the pillow as you creep away. Well, shall we? Yes, and then, of course, after that comes the yearning. Oh, my Lord, the yearning. Oh, in that masculine world of boots and steel and cursing. Well, simply no softness. No softness at all.
A message for motorists in Devon. News is that a new flyover intersection has just opened.
It's because of them that you understand about me.
What's that?
Because of those women. Because of their beauty, you know what ugliness is like to live with.
Well, ugliness, but you're not ugly, Miss Lorimer.
Oh, you don't make me feel so. Oh, not since that first day. Not since that day you said it's good to find a new face. I haven't felt ugly in your company.
No, no, no. Oh, no, no. You're not ugly, Miss Lorimer. No, no.
Yes. I never married either. Because no one ever wanted me. When I was a little girl, I used to look into the mirror and there I'd be. I knew even then I was going to miss out. You're right, I am a lonely heart, I dare say. I loved a man once. We used to sing in the same choir in Bury St. Edmunds. For 8 years, once a week, I loved that man. Every Tuesday evening, I used to stand there with a sheet of music in my hands, waiting for him. And afterwards, we'd eat biscuits together and drink instant coffee out of beakers.
Of beakers?
Huh? He never said anything, but I could see it all in his eyes. For some reason, he didn't find me ugly.
Well, of course not, good heavens. The fellow fancied you.
He was older than me. Oh, a lot older. But you know, I never even knew his Christian name.
What's that?
E.R. Harrison. Went rather well tonight, Mr. Harrison, I'd say. And he'd smile and stir sugar into his instant coffee.
What do you mean to say that the fellow never so much as...
He was married. Unhappily married. You could see that also in his eyes. She used to come to the performances. Cruel-looking woman. He worked in an office, the Eastern Electricity Board.
And you were a teacher?
At another school, like St. Monica's. I used to dream at night of his coming to choir practice and suddenly singing out all the wrong words. Suddenly singing that he was divorced. And in the dream, I'd run and run and run away from that school, and he'd be waiting on a station platform, and I'd be beautiful because I felt like that.
And instead of which, it'd been left to an old mother like me to come and rescue you. What?
I've got over E.R. Harrison by now. And it's nice to be rescued instead of just standing there drinking instant coffee. Whatever am I doing? Oh, my God! Whatever am I doing? Monday, third period, 3A geography. A housekeeper, they'll say. She's become a housekeeper just so that he can get rid of his job.
Oh, Miss Lorimer, I am glad you're coming to Ivy Cottage.
We did what they said couldn't be done. Two hearts were taken and made into one. Oh, we were made for each other.
Table for two at 8:45 in the dining room, please.
Yes.
Tell me what's on, Muriel.
Well, mock turtle patty, chicken bread sauce, sprouts and carrots mashed, and sherry trifle.
Ah, and the bottle of Louis 63. Miss Lorimer and I are celebrating, Muriel.
Good evening, Jock.
Oh, good evening, sir. Left your album.
Did I, Jock? Well, never mind the album. You serve us two gin and tonics, Jock.
Certainly, Jock.
Here on the Rezzles.
Oh, yes?
Yes, yes. Miss Lorimer and I are tying our loose ends together. She's about to become the housekeeper at Ivy Cottage, Jock.
Well, that's tip-top news, sir.
Yes, isn't it indeed? So hurry up with those drinks like a good old warrior.
So, you'll be letting Mrs. Hinch go, will you, sir?
Jock, Mrs. Hinch is simply not fit to tie Miss Lorimer's laces. Now, remember that.
Aye, of course she isn't. A terrible woman. That'll be 50p, sir.
50p, Jock, there you are. And keep the change, my boy.
Thank you very much, sir.
Oh. I've something for you. Yes, there she is. There she is, that's her. That's her. Daisy Ashley.
Oh, yes. I'm glad I'm coming to Ivy Cottage, too.
Yes, I'm sure you are. And that's old Harry Tomlinson. He, you know, threw a shop window in Melton Mowbray in 1927, was it? Yes, I think it was 27. Anyway, come along now, drink up, and we'll have another, shall we?
I'm not a very good cook, you know.
Well, it doesn't matter. I'll do you curries. Oh, yes, I'm an expert in curries. The curries of the Punjab, actually.
Oh.
Come on now. Business? two more large ones, please, Doc.
Right, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much.
Thank you, Doc.
There we are.
The guard needs attention at Ivy Cottage. I've noticed when I passed. We could plant snowdrops all over that little lawn. And hollyhocks. Oh, don't you love hollyhocks, General?
You know, I think you should call me Adam.
Adam
St. John. That's my name. Adam St. John Suffolk.
Yes, I know. I read it.
Well, I don't want to be like that. That fellow, you know, the electricity fellow. I don't want you not to know my name.
I don't think I should, General.
Adam.
My name is Elsie.
Elsie? Very well then, Elsie. If you want to put down snowdrops at Ivy Cottage, you put down snowdrops at Ivy Cottage.
And we could have a rock garden at the back. There's plenty of room, you know. Mm-hmm. And herbs. Oh, I've always wanted to grow herbs. Rosemary and thyme, marjoram, basil.
And parsnips, huh? I'm very fond of parsnips.
Well, we'll grow parsnips, of course.
Mashed with butter. I'm sorry. You never see them nowadays. You never seem to see mashed parsnips on a menu. Never.
Oh, I shall be happy in a garden. I haven't had a garden since I was a child.
Now, artichokes, perhaps? Hmm? Globe artichokes. You know, I'm very partial to a really good globe artichoke.
Ah, gentlemen. 210 quid. Get the drinks, Percy. 40 up on last year.
What's that?
Takings, old boy.
Ah, oh.
I'm going to be General Suffolk's housekeeper.
Is that right? Elsie and I are going to grow parsnips together now, aren't we? Hmm?
Good God almighty.
Well, now, come along, Jumbo, you have a drink, will you?
Yes. Whiskey right, and soda, right, but right. Percy's getting you one.
So, I'll buy his toothbrushes in future, Mrs. Constantine.
Housekeeper?
Yes, I'm going to give in my notice at St. Monica's.
You're insane, Miss Lorimer.
No, not at all insane.
You intend to live at Ivy Cottage?
Yes, I'm going to do that.
Now, look here, Miss Lorimer. I should be extremely careful if I were you.
Careful? Why should I be careful? They've never treated me particularly well at St. Monica's. Miss Heaslip's an inhuman kind of person. The General and I get on.
You know what I mean.
No, I don't know what you mean, Mrs. Considine.
I'm talking about him.
Well, you could hardly call him inhuman.
He'll make demands on you.
Oh, I'm not afraid of hard work. I'm quite strong, you know, though I may not look
it. He makes demands on Mrs. Hinch.
Well, yes, she's his charwoman. Of course he does.
Don't be a bloody fool.
I don't know what you mean. I don't know what you're talking about.
Everybody knows about the General and Mrs. Hinch.
Give you, Doc. There you are, Jumbo. The little thing's gone to see to something, I suppose. Well, she'll be back in a moment. I got two for us while I was about it. Well, good health, Jumbo. Good health.
Long before you ever spoke to me, I used to wonder who you were.
Come and housekeep for me, Miss Lorimer.
And then I asked one day in a tobacconist's, who is that dignified man?
It's all right, old chap.
You know, I don't understand it. I thought she'd just gone to the lavatory or something. She was, a moment ago, she was sitting there talking about her herb garden.
Put that in your pocket, old chap.
And now she just apparently disappeared. Anyway, As you have a drink, and we won't give you.
Now,
jumbo.
Don't you think we had enough, old chap?
Two large ones, Jock, please, with Jumbo and myself. One for person.
Now, look here, old chap.
Do you not understand it, Emily? We were getting on like a couple of houses on fire, and she does a disappearing trick. I don't understand at all.
Two gins, please, Jock, and split a bottle of tonic. Oh, that's all right, old boy. Not at all. Oh, and something to the general, Jock.
Really? That's very, very kind of you.
Cheers, gentlemen.
Sorry, I couldn't come to give that film in the afternoon, Jock. The boy here, Jock, is very anxious to see a picture about guns. I really half promised to go with him, but I'm
sorry. Really? Sorry,
indeed, yes. Thank you, very, very much. There you are. Here you are, Jumbo.
Oh, that's very good of you,
General. The outside one, if you take it, that's right.
Right.
You got it?
Yep.
Here's Percy. That's all right.
It wouldn't have been right, old chap, a girl like that living at Ivy Cottage.
She's had a sheltered life, you know.
Sheltered life? Who's had a sheltered life?
Elsie Lorimer.
Little Elsie Lorimer, she's sitting over there as happy as a linnet.
It wouldn't have been right, old chap.
Right? What wouldn't have been right?
You know what I mean, old chap.
I did not know what you mean, Mrs. Constantine.
Bones can't have been having a very successful season.
Quiet, Percy, just for one moment. I'm speaking. Now then, Mrs. Constantine. What did you say to Elsie Lorimer?
Nothing at all, old chap.
Now, please stop calling me old chap and tell me now, what did you say to her?
Now, don't get shirty, old boy. Miss Lorimer's an extremely naive young woman.
What did you say to her?
Miss Lorimer's not Mrs. Hinch. Everyone knows Mrs. Hinch occasionally stays late at Ivy Cottage.
You cow! Cow!
Come on.
Cow. Cow. Cow.
You've held between your hands thousands and thousands of lives. You've charted the boundaries of nations.
Little Alma, I want to explain to you.
Great for his age, the waitress says. I'd rather you weren't seen with him, Miss Heaslip says. Dirty old man.
I want to explain to you about Mrs. Hinch.
You've lost your last battle, General Suffolk.
I wasn't sober one night.
Who cares if you were sober? With tooth and nail, you have defended this island, laying down your life time and time again, and now you end with Mrs. Pinch.
I wasn't sober one night, and she was there. God knows why. But there she was, so have a drink, Mrs. Hinch, I said, wondering just for a moment who the devil the woman was. Well, it was pleasant in the room, it was warm. The woman was smiling at me. You're looking very perky tonight, General, she said. And then she nudged me in the ribs with her elbow, exactly in the way that a station barmaid used to do, way back, sometime 20-something. Totty, somebody's Totty Grimes it was, Totty Grimes.
They buy you things and say you're looking perky. You deceive a ridiculous schoolmistress.
You're not ridiculous, Miss Lorimer.
Why should you end like this? How can you let yourself, you, who have known so much, how can you so bitterly end?
On the night that I'm not sober and she's there, she can make me feel young. I hate her, but she can do that.
And I loved you because you had reached impotence, or so I thought. I'm worse than any of them. They pass Ivy Cottage and think their sniggering thoughts. They see you walking on the beach, perhaps, as I did, and snigger also, knowing about Mrs. Hinch. But I have insulted you more.
Come to Ivy Cottage and
I would be afraid in Ivy Cottage, the way Mrs. Hinch is not afraid because she doesn't mind. One day soon, she'll simply not go back to Strand Street, and you'll threaten her with the police and she'll take no notice. And when she doesn't, you'll go yourself to the police station and she'll know you won't enter it. Because you need her.
Miss Lorimer.
I wouldn't have been any good to you. I wouldn't have taken my clothes off on the evenings when you weren't sober, General Suffolk. I'm sorry about that.
I wouldn't have wanted you to. All I wanted was a housekeeper. It was just a way of getting rid of her.
You mustn't get rid of her.
Care for a little whiskey? Oh, no.
One day you'll die and leave your cottage to Mrs. Hinch and everything that's in it, which is what she wants and why she bothers. You'll leave it all to an unpleasant woman, because that was the woman who, of all the women, was there at the end, reminding you that you weren't yet quite dead. That's quite something, you know. More than I could give you. Because I'm prudish and awkward due to ugliness and frightened of all that kind of thing.
Miss Lorimer.
I shall return to sanity and to St. Monica's tonight. To the glances of the girls. To geography on Mondays, third period, 3A. To Sunday walks, to the common room, clicking with tongues and knitting needles. Don't worry about me or how I end. It's your tragedy, General, not mine. It's your story. You, who have had your day. You. Who rode to war on a horse. who defended your beloved island and saw it safe. It's your tragedy that you think to yourself now. Oh God, I could live for another 20 years. Goodbye, General Suffolk.